Alright, so in this week's video, I want to show you how to make some interesting backgrounds in After Effects using some simple techniques. If that sounds interesting, let's get started. Alright, so my first technique is start with a photo. Starting with a photo is a great stepping stone for a really interesting background. Let's have a look at this photo that I took. This is where I work. So I went outside the classroom, walked down the hallway, looked up at the ceiling, and took a pretty interesting shot. So the idea behind this technique is to find an image or take an image of something that has some interesting highlights and shadows, but we're not looking for specific small details, we're looking for macro details. So if you kind of just blur the forms together and look at areas of shadow and highlight, you can create some very interesting looking backgrounds. So what we would start with something like this is perhaps a Gaussian blur effect. You could also use a fast box blur as well, but I quite like Gaussian. So we can increase the blurriness to the point at which the forms fade away and we're only left with value. And perhaps color as well, like there is essence of color in here and that's fine too, and perhaps that's what you want. But if we blur this to the point where we can barely make out that kind of cross-section beam, we're kind of left with an asymmetrical vignette with an area where it's kind of like highlights kind of cutting diagonally across. We could use this as if it was some kind of like volumetric god ray or something like that. So right away, we have created something that we could use as a background. Another type of blur that we could use if you want to give the effect that it looks like it's out of focus, like a camera defocus, would be a camera lens blur effect. This is quite heavy in terms of processing, but if you do something like maybe 350, you can really begin to see kind of like those bokeh rings from the camera. So if we animate this, you can kind of see it kind of looks like it's going out of focus. So right away, we have something that's pretty interesting already. But what if we're not happy with the color? Well, that brings us to the next part here. So what we could do is grab a tint effect. So if we're only looking for the value, a tint effect is really useful just to quickly make a black and white version. You can also use a hue and saturation. So a hue and saturation does also allow you to desaturate, but not all at once. So we could disable tint here, still have the original image, and then we can use the master saturation. So we could lower this, and then it's almost the same as what tint does, just to pulling out all the color. Or we could increase the saturation here to something more like this. It's very saturated. Now these colors together are pretty hideous, so you can just cycle through the hue. We could do something perhaps more like that. It's very colorful. Drop down the saturation a bit. And if you kind of like these main values, but there's something that you don't like, so like perhaps this green area that you're just really not happy with, you could just grab a curves effect, specifically go to the green channel and just pull out some green. And if that's a little bit too much, well, you can go to the blue channel, add perhaps a bit more blue into it. Or you can go to the red channel, pull out a bit more red if it's going too pink. And we've eliminated now quite a bit of that green. Also just play around with this, lower the saturation a little bit, and that kind of goes away. Go to our contrast curve, lower the shadows, boost the highlights, and we've got something pretty interesting already. Okay, so another thing you can do, let's go back up to the hue saturation, turn off the master saturation, turn on colorize, and then you can kind of infuse the midtones with color. So we can increase the saturation here. You can also cycle through the hue just as you would before, but now it's mostly just one color. So that's a really good effect that you can use as well. I'm gonna go back to what I had before. I quite like that one. So if you want something that's not static, you want your background to move, well, there's lots of things you can do to do that. You can either just scale this up and then just move the position or something like that. But if you want to do something a little bit more interesting, you could use turbulent displacement. Type in turbulent and grab a turbulent displace. Now you probably want this to be before the blur, but it doesn't particularly matter where you put this. So we could animate the evolution with a time expression. So we alt click the stopwatch, type in time, perhaps 180. So every second it goes halfway around. So with something like this, we've got the background to kind of wobble. All right, let's say you don't have a camera with you or you don't have time to go and take your own pictures, just use Google. One thing I found is particularly useful is to search for interior lighting. So interior lighting is going to give you a lot of images of very well-lit rooms. So we have things like this. We're looking for composition, but not of the forms. We're only looking at regions of light areas or dark areas. And we can ignore the color and just look at value, or we can look at both value and color. So things like this would give you very interesting results when blurred. So of course you need to be careful with copyright, but if you're blurring the image to the point where it's completely indistinguishable, it is a useful way just to experiment with different things. You could even make your own background based on the heavily blurred version that you found online. So it just gives you some really, really quick ideas. Now, one of the really great things about this technique, if you have several different pictures or different images, it's very quick to just cycle through different images. All right, so I've loaded in some different images here. And what we can do is really, really quickly drop them into the layer that we have here with all the effects on and just see what they look like. So the way you do this in After Effects, you have the layer selected in the comp, and then you have the image selected up here in your project window. You hold down the Alt key, and then you just click and drag the layer on top of the existing layer. So now we have something like this, different colors. We'll have a look at different lighting. You could turn off the hue and saturation and curves and only look at the original image here, or we could turn on tint and only look at value. Look at another one here, do it again. And it's very, very quick just to have a look at different images. We could just scale this one up, turn the hue back on, look at our curves and how that affects it, grab another one. And the images that you want to use, you don't want to see any of the original forms. You don't want to be using something that's very clearly copyrighted. If we're only using kind of a very, very, very blurry, like there's no detail left in this at all. It's just value. And it's just like blurred value. It's like an interesting gradient. You need to be careful with doing things like this, but if you do it a lot, it's a very good way of just experimenting with other areas, other gradients. Like this one, something like this is quite attractive. We could still animate this like we did before, cycle through different animations. You have another one here. Color is quite hideous with these on, but we could look at just the grayscale one, or we could look at the original image, put a curves on it. We could even just reset the curves, do our own, and do another version, something more like that. So it's very, very quick just to experiment with different ideas. Okay, so that was the first idea. Let me open up a new comp here and we'll go to a second technique. So this one's going to produce a little bit more simple backgrounds, but what we do is start with a solid. I almost never use this, I just use a fill effect. And the effect, just type in fill. It makes it easier to animate the color if you wanted to do that, and it's also just easier to change it instead of having to go up to layer, solid settings, or control shift Y. So what we could do here, pick a color that you like, maybe something, maybe a bluish color, something a deeper blue. And then what we do on this, duplicate the layer, control D. I'm gonna solo this just so it's a bit more clear. Go up to the rectangle tool, change it to the ellipse tool. Double click it. So double clicking that will produce a mask that fits your canvas. All right, so then click F and then just feather this. All right, so then unsolo it, change the blending mode to add. And right away, we have a much more interesting looking background. And then you can do this again. You can do it with another one. Click M to access your mask, open up the full mask menu. And then you could take in the expansion to get a highlight just in the very center, something more like that. But this is an excellent technique, especially if you want something that's very, very simple, but still a little bit more abstract. So if you want to change the color, very simple. All we do is add an adjustment layer. The adjustment layer will affect everything below. Grab a hue and saturation, and then just cycle through various hues. Also lower the saturation if that's a little bit too intense. But it's an excellent way just to experiment with very simple backgrounds. So another idea, still using solids. Let me grab another solid, is to use the gradient ramp. So just type in ramp, pull this over, and what we can do with it is instead of using a linear ramp, we can say radial ramp. And the radial ramp, we can move this target to the center, swap the values, and we can use this kind of like we just did, but instead of having a layer underneath, we're just doing it all on one layer. It's a little bit different. It is going to be perfectly round, so it might not be what you're looking for. But it's again another really useful way to make a more interesting background. Again, hue and saturation. We could do something like a colorize this time. Just play around with different values this way. All right, so the last technique also involves solids. So let's quickly just make a new solid. Grab another fill effect. Maybe do something more like that. All right, what we're gonna do, click that layer and turn on the 3D switch. Grab a camera just so we can see what we're doing. Click C, you can rotate around with the camera. And what we can do now is make a light. So we could use a parallel light, which is kind of like a directional light, like the sun. Yeah, spotlight, something kind of like this. Increase the intensity a little bit so you can see a bit better. Or you could just reduce the fall off and set the intensity back to 100. Something kind of like that. Click the select tool and you can move it up and down. So basically what you've got here, if we delete the camera, just so we don't particularly need it right now, you can create your own interesting looking gradients. Something like that. If you don't really particularly like the spotlight, you can use a point light. So a point light, let's grab a new light here, select point light. Move this, and then you can duplicate it. You can have multiple lights. You can move one down here, but you can add as many of these lights as you want, change the values, change the colors. You need to be careful if you're going to stack lots of lights on together. You might need to go in and just lower the intensity of these lights. So you would just click T underneath these layers as if you're going to animate the opacity, essentially. Then just play around with the values. You can double click any of these lights and also change the color if you wanted to do that. Like a purpley color, something like that. Okay, so there's a little bit more dynamic way. You can even get these lights and animate the lights so you have areas that are going to be shifting in their shadows and light areas. You could get the lights to flicker if that's something that would suit your needs. All right, so finally, what I wanted to look at was some stock footage elements that you could just drop over the top of these, especially something like more particle based that you can use to also enhance your background, but give it a little bit more detail. All right, so if you're looking for free stock footage, YouTube is a great resource. You'll find a lot of people that have free content on channels. You can also look at sites that do sell content. They'll often have like monthly or weekly giveaways of just free stuff. So right here, I have a set of particles that was for free that I got years and years ago. I can't even remember the site that I got it from. But these types of things are absolutely invaluable to motion graphics artists and animators that are just looking for something to spice up a background. So for example, I could bring this one over here, scale this up quite a bit, change the mode to perhaps add, or if that's going to be a little bit too bright, you can do screen to make sure there's not going to be any clipping, but add in my case is going to be all right. And right away we have a very interesting, dreamy looking background. So if that's something that you're going for, using particles like this is an excellent way to do it. If this goes too fast for you, what you could do is go up to layer, time stretch. You have to be careful with this. If you do it too much, it's not going to look very good, unless you blur it, in which case you could probably stretch it as much as you want if you just wanted some subtle motion. But you could do something like 200%, which will double the length of it. You'd want to make sure you also have frame blending on for the layer and for the comp. You get something kind of like this. It's not going to look fantastic, so what I would recommend is that you do blur it. So you could go up to add another camera lens blur, but this is great if you want your particles to look like they're out of focus. If you want to reduce the flickering, you'd probably need to increase the scale so the particles are slightly larger so they're not going in and out of focus. You could also use a different type of blur, perhaps a Gaussian blur or a fast blur. Something more like this. And then you've got something pretty interesting. Now, this might not be what you're looking for. Maybe the particles are too small, too quick, but you just have to experiment with different types of effects. You could also just simply lower the opacity, and then you've got something that's pretty interesting. All right, guys, that wraps up this week's video. You learned something, drop a like. You have a question or something, post a comment, and I'll be back next Tuesday with another video. All right, peace.